Hello and welcome everyone to the course Industrial Robotics and Automation. In today's class, we'll be continuing with the electro-pneumatic system. In particular, we'll be doing the circuit design, okay, problem for the electro-pneumatic systems. Okay, so if you can just recall from previous lecture, okay, I had told you that in contrary to your pneumatic system, where you just have only a single circuit diagram, okay, your electro-pneumatic systems have two of them. Okay, so the one of the diagram is your electrical circuit control diagram, okay, and the other one is your pneumatic diagram. Okay, so basically related to your power elements. Okay, even if you see here in this picture, you can see your dark lines, okay, that means your double acting cylinder getting connected to this 5x2 double solenoid valve. Okay, so this portion will be actually be drawn, and that will constitute your pneumatic portion of the diagram. However, all your controls, when you have to extend the cylinder, when you have to retract back, okay, all your input elements and your processing of all those things, they will have to be included in your electrical portion of the diagrams. Okay, so today in this lecture we'll be focusing on first your electrical diagram, and then towards the end of today's lecture we will see how we will be making both the pneumatic as well as electrical portion of a few examples of electro-pneumatic systems. Fine. So to start with the electric circuit diagram. Okay, so what is a circuit diagram? A circuit diagram shows the details of the design of systems, okay, the installations and the apparatus. Fine. So basically it is a graphical symbols of different items, okay, of the equipment. For example, if you see here, okay, this is a symbolic representation of a push button, okay, a normally open push button. Similarly, if you see here, this is a symbolic representation of your valve solenoid, okay, or a solenoid coil here. Okay, so we'll go into much more details of all these things later, but just I'm showing you. So these are some of the symbols of the equipments that you are actually using in your electro-pneumatic systems. Okay, and then second, what is those? They it shows your connection between these items. So if you see, this solenoid valve, okay, is directly connected to this push button switch. That means whenever you are going to engage this push button, it will lead to your energization of this solenoid valve. Okay, then you have your equipment identifiers. Okay, that means all these letters and your numericals. For example, your S1, S2. Somewhere you will be seeing in this circuit that we'll be using the capital letter B, then your Y, H. Okay, so all those things have different letters, okay, they denote different types of symbolic representation of certain equipments. Okay, so you have different types of equipment identifiers, and they are also made with some specific purpose. Suppose if you see here, the design here itself, okay, of this push button switch, then here also you have your symbolic representation of your solenoid valve, and then finally we will be also having your terminal identifiers. Okay, so that means if you have multiple number of terminals in a single electrical diagram, okay, then how are you going to suppose make any corrections, or how are you going to go through, or how are you going to locate a certain amount of a certain quantity of your equipment or your these items that are placed in certain part of the circuit. So if you see, these are the numberings that we are actually done to this terminals. Okay, for example, your 1, 2, 3, 4. Similarly, you have terminals numberings for your open, normally open contact, as well as your normally closed contact. Okay, so these things are there in a electrical circuit diagrams, and these we are going to study today in details. Okay, covering all those points. Fine. So first, we will be seeing what are the different symbols for our switches that we use. Okay, so if you see, the first one is your manually operated switches. In this, you have your push button and your control switches, which are detentive in nature. Okay, also known as your detent switches. These we have discussed the working principle of all those of all these switches in detail in the previous class. Here we are just going to stick to the symbols. However, if you see, even in the push buttons, you will be having two categories. One is your normally open part, and this is your normally closed. Yes.
So one.
Sorry, I did not get you. Can you come again?
One.
These numbers 1, 2, 3, 4. All this. Actually, I cannot get you.
Your previous slide, sir.
Yes.
That is why.
Yeah, this is a solenoid valve. It is a representation of a solenoid valve. We'll be discussing it in details later. Fine. Right now, I just showed you what are the different types of equipment identifiers. Okay. And the connection between all this, we will be discussing in detail, okay, in a later slide. Just now, just remember that these are the different symbols, okay, of all these things. For example, you have your terminal identifiers, and you have equipment identifiers. Finally, okay, then you have graphical symbols of all those things, right now, and then finally your connection between these things. Fine, okay. So coming back to your electrical symbols for switches. Okay, we see like this is a push button. Okay, all these symbols are there for a push button. This one, if you see, even in push button, we have a normally open contact, and this is a normally closed contact. That means when this switch is engaged, it will lead to closing of the circuit. Here, when this push button is engaged, it will open the circuit. Fine. The lower one, okay, this one, just if you see these symbols here. This one is for your control switches, which are detective in nature, just like your switches of your home, okay, where you switch on a fan, and then if you just press engage it in an on position, it will remain in that position until you should not switch it off, okay. So these are also known as your detective switches. Your normally open and your normally closed switches are also known as your make switches or your break switches, okay. That means this switch actually makes a circuit, or this push button makes a circuit, and this push button breaks a circuit, okay. So they are also known as your make switches or your break switches, and they are also known as your normally open or your normally closed. Fine. Then you have your limit switches, okay. The limit switches, I told you, they are in the form of, for example, roller valves that are placed at either end of your linear actuators to sense either the retracted position or the the completely extended positions, and these are generally actuated by cam mechanism. So if you see, these are the symbols for it. Okay, fine. Again, they can be of a normally open contact type. That means whenever your roller valve is hit by a piston rod, okay, and that means they either make a circuit or they break a circuit if the circuit is already made in an earlier case, okay, or a normally closed contact that is seen here. You also have pressure switches. Okay, that means your binary output type of pressure switches. You also have your analog pressure sensors. Okay, that will give you a continuous value for a certain amount of pressure. But we will limit our discussions to our binary type of pressure switches. That means it will either give an on and off signal. So whenever your certain pressure is it is detected in a system which is more than the preset value, okay, then you will either make a circuit or it will break a circuit. Okay, so these are some of the few symbols that we'll be using extensively while we are drawing our electro-pneumatic circuits. Then we will go on to our electrical symbols for sensors. Okay, so see, when I am putting out these type of, or when I am just telling you that these are the circuit diagrams, it is not that only these many components are there. Okay, you have a variety of components, but since we have a paucity of time here, okay, of the lecture, we will be limiting our discussions to a few general switches and your sensors that we will be commonly using it in our practice problems also. Okay, so some of the few proximity sensors, okay, is shown here, the symbols. For example, this is a capacitive sensors here, this is a magnetic nature, this one is inductive, and this one is optical. Okay, so if you see, more or less all the symbolic representation of the sensors remains the same. That means you will have a power source here, you will have a ground connection here, and this will be your output connection. Okay, these are the signs to detect for the proximity. And then you will be having a normally open type of contact here, so that whenever something is detected in its vicinity, the actuation mechanism would be your capacitive circuit. I will not go details into it, okay, much details into it. The working you must have studied in your earlier lectures in your sensors covered by Professor Arun. So here it would just make the circuit and you will be getting an output signal here. Okay. So one example I have shown how your basic proximity sensors are connected in a electrical diagram. So if you see, this is a sensor here. Okay. It is a capacitive type of sensors. You will be having a 24 volt connection here, and then you will be having a 0 volt connection or the ground connection. Okay. So initially this is a normally open type of circuit here. Okay. So you will not be having any response. But the moment this sensor detects something in its proximity, then what would happen? It would lead to closing of this circuit, and then you will be getting an output signal here, which will be equal to your 24 volt signal. That is the power supply, whatever you are providing, that you will be getting at the output of those signal. And then with that signal, whatever you want to do, suppose here I am triggering a relay. Okay, relays are denoted by my capital letter K. Okay, and A1 and A2 are the armature current terminals, okay, for the relays. So here with this type of output of the sensors, I'm actually just triggering a relay, so that I can see here. But this is the actual connection diagram, if you see, of your sensors. So you have your 24 volt connection, and then you have your ground, and when something is detected in its vicinity, it will give you some output. Okay, so all these sensors, if you see, the working principles may be different, but in terms of our electrical circuit design, they will all be connected in the same way. One end being connected to the power supply, the other end to the ground, and the third end as your output signal, so that whenever you have something in its vicinity, this would be giving an either an on or off, or off signal, either an on or an off signal. Okay, so if something is detected, you will be getting an on signal. Okay, and if nothing is detected, you will be not getting any signal from its output. Fine. So these are just some of the sensors, okay, proximity sensors. Fine. Then again, we will come to our, after we have just gone through the basic, your switches and your sensors, symbolic representations, we will see like how can we identify these components? Because again, some of you have asked like what was the letter Y there, or what was the letter S? Let us just go much more details into the different types of letters that are designated to represent a certain component type. Okay, fine. So the components in the circuit diagram, okay, of a control system are identified by a letter in accordance with the following table. Okay, so if you see here, a limit switch, it is denoted by a letter S. Then all your manually operated push buttons, your input elements, for example, your detentive switch, okay. So all those things will be denoted by letter S. Even your roller valve, okay. So if you see here, your limit switches, that is a roller valve, they will also be identified by the capital letter S. Your reed switches, all your proximity sensors, okay, pressure switches, they will all be denoted by the capital letter B. Then your indicators, such as your lamps and all those things, they will be denoted by capital letter H. All the relays in the circuit will be denoted by your letter capital K. And this solenoid coil of a valve, okay. So that solenoid valve is just, if you just remember the types of valve when we studied. So the shifting of the spool mechanism, it was either manually or either mechanically or by pilot operated. And the fourth category was shifting of the valve using a solenoid, okay. So that means if you have solenoids at the either end of the valve or only one end of the valve, depending upon your valve configuration, then whenever you have to actuate a certain position of a valve, that means you have to shift the spool within the valve itself. Okay, so that spool is shifted or repositioned using your solenoid. Okay, so which consists of, again, if you see here, then electromagnet setup, which when energized, it either attracts or repels the solenoid and repels your spool, and then opening and closing some of the ports, okay, of the valve. Okay, so that all valves will be denoting by the capital letter Y. Fine. And if you have, suppose, multiple components of the same, for example, say in my circuit, if I have three or four push buttons, okay, then what I would do, I would start using my numbers, okay, to separate them. For example, S1, S2, S3, S4. Say suppose I have my sensors, okay, two sensors that are placed on the first cylinder, and I have suppose four cylinders. Then again I will be writing as one B1 and one B2 to identify two sensors that are put on my cylinder one. And if suppose I am having these two sensors again on my third cylinder, then I will be writing 3B1 and 3B2. Okay. So B1, B2, B3 are the number of sensors, while the letter before the alphabet actually denotes your cylinder. Okay, that which cylinder is it associated to. Similarly, you may have 1S1, 1S2, okay, as your roller valve. Okay, that is actually associated with your cylinder 1. Okay, suppose if I am writing 3S1, 3S2, that means I am actually determining my limit switch or my letter, roller valve associated with my third cylinder. Fine. So these are the different identifying letters and your numerical values that are given to identify different type of components in the electrical circuit diagrams. Fine. So if you see here, okay, this is a typical. Don't go right now much into the detail like how we are going to this work. Just try to identify. Okay. So if I can see here, I have my. This is my detentive switch, okay, or my control switch, push button type. So it is denoted by S1. So I have another push button here, S2. Fine. Then I have my limit switch, okay, 1S1. Then I have my another limit switch here, okay. This is a normally open type of limit switch as 1S2. Okay. Then I can identify some relays, for example, K1, K2, K3, K4. Okay. These are my relays. I can also identify my lamps here denoted by H, okay, H1, that means indicating this is only the first lamp here. Similarly, I can identify my solenoid valve here, okay, denoted by 1Y1. What else can you identify here? You can also identify some pressure sensors, okay, denoted by your 1B1. That means this pressure sensor is actually associated with my one of the pneumatic cylinder, okay, or if there is only the single, then there may be that this cylinder is associated with my cylinder 1A. Fine. So these are the different type of components, okay, that are here. You can also see we have some certain current paths, although we'll be discussing about the current paths in the later, but okay, just let us put our limitations to only your identification of the components. Okay. So if you see here, again, the components shown in the circuit diagram, it is a manually operated switches, S1, S2, S3. You had your limit switches, 1S1, 1S2. Then you had your pressure switch denoted by 1B1. You had your relays, K1, K2, K3, K4. Then you had a solenoid coil denoted by 1Y1. Why is 1 used here? Although if you had seen in this setter that a solenoid valve, only Y is there to represent. So if I write Y1 and Y2, that means two solenoid valves. Okay. But if I write 1Y1 and 1Y2, that means, if you can just recall, if you have a double acting cylinder, okay, and if I place a 5x2 double solenoid valve, okay, to control this double acting cylinder, then I will be having my solenoid at the either end of the valves, right? Okay, so that whenever I want to extend the cylinder, I would engage my left hand side solenoid, okay, depending upon the circuit diagram, and if I want to retract the cylinder, I would engage my right hand side of the solenoid. That means I am having Y1 and Y2 to designate two types of solenoid. Now say suppose this solenoid is actually controlling the first cylinder. Suppose you have 10 cylinders in your system, okay, and this solenoid is using or is used to control my cylinder 1A, because A is denoted by a cylinder. Similarly, you may have 1A, 2A, 3A, 4A as 10A. That means 10 cylinders are I'm using. So that means when I write 1Y1 and 1Y2, I understand, okay, that this solenoid valve is actually used to control my cylinder 1A, okay. And 1Y1 is to control one envelope of my 5x2 valve controlling cylinder 1A, and 1Y2 is to control my the other envelope of a 5x2 valve for controlling the same cylinder 1A, that is to extend and to retract. Similarly, suppose I have a 5x2 double solenoid valve to control my fifth cylinder, say. Then what I would name it as? I would name it as the solenoid valve of those cylinders as 5Y1 and 5Y2. Okay, the letter 5 denoting that. And these solenoid valves are controlling my cylinder 5A, okay, and the Y1 and Y2 are the two ends of the solenoid of a 5x2 double solenoid valve to either extend or to retract my cylinder number 5, okay. So these are the symbols that are used okay, or my identifying letters that are used to name different type of components. Fine. Then now let us come to the, once you have identified your all your, you have known how to make your make a symbolic representation of your components, and then you have also known how to give some numbers or some identification to those components that you are using. Now once we know these two, now we should proceed with the circuit diagram guidelines, okay, that how we have to make a circuit. So the rule says, in the circuit diagram of an electro-pneumatic control system, the graphical representation of components required to implement logic circuits and sequences are entered consecutively from top to the bottom, okay, and from the left to the right. So if you see this circuit diagram, these are your current path. If you see one is here, then you have 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. That means I am actually proceeding from left to right, okay, if I have number of current paths here to control. The other thing is what, if you see here, it says that the circuits, the components are entered from top to bottom, okay, where you see all your relay coils and your valve coils, okay, are always drawn beneath the contacts. If you see this example here, okay, that means see, these are your relay coils, relay K1, K2, K3, K4, and all your output elements, for example, your 1Y1, because solenoid is ultimately an output, okay, because only with that output you are controlling your extension of the cylinders, right? So, and all your lamps, so the, all the output devices come towards the bottom most of your circuit, and all your input devices followed by all your logic operations, for example, whether you want to make an AND circuit or an OR circuit, or how are you processing those circuits, okay, those relays connections, they will all be part of your top portion of your electrical diagram. For example, if you see, these are the top circuits where we have different type of connections here, okay. So once all these conditions are true, then my relay K1 will get actuated. That means my all the output elements are towards the bottom, and all my input elements along with all the signal processing that is to be done, they are placed on the top part of the circuit. Similarly, the circuits are drawn from left to right. That means if I have few components, I may require only 2 to 3 circuit current parts, then my circuit would say, suppose, end here. If I have to add more number of cylinders and more number of output elements, then slowly and I will proceed from left to your right, adding more number of current paths here, say 11, 12, 30, 40, 50, depending upon what, how you, do you want to draw the circuits, okay. So that is what is written here in this sentence, okay, that your, the components required to implement logic circuits and sequences are entered consecutively from top to bottom and from your left to right. Fine. Then you have your relay coils and your valve coils. That means it basically says all your outputs and all those things, they are drawn beneath the contacts. Other measures to ensure that a circuit diagram is easy to read includes your division into individual current paths. Okay. So for example, if you see here, I have my current path denoted by numericals. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4. So that it is easy to understand when you want to try to fix some bug. Okay, into this circuit, if you want to try to correct the circuit, you can know where the error is. Okay, that is why they are all numbered. Secondly, you have identification of the devices by your contact. Okay, by your contacts, by letters and numbers, as we have previously discussed. And then again, a subdivision into a control circuit and your main circuit, that we'll be discussing a bit more in detail. If you see, like, you will be able to know further, okay, that this part of a circuit, right from current number 1 to 8, is your control circuit, whereas your main circuit, why do I call the main circuit? Because the actual actuation of your output element. So you have two output elements here, that is your lamp H1 and your solenoid valve Y1, okay. So they actually form your main circuit diagram, because it is only this output that you have to consider, because in your circuit you are actuating two outputs. So this is considered as your main circuit, whereas this is your control circuits. What are these control circuits? What are the different type of conditions that should be met to engage my lamp S1 or to engage my solenoid valve S1? So all those processing, all those things, they are actually done towards the left hand side of the circuit. And your main circuit controlling your outputs are just written towards the end of the circuit. So you also divide your circuit into your control element circuit as well as your main circuits. Okay. So these are just for easy identification of your circuit diagrams. Fine. So these are the conventions that will be following. Suppose if you see here, and the circuit diagram of an electro pneumatic control shown in the figure that you see has 10 current paths. Current paths 1 to 8 belong to your control circuit, whereas the current path 9 and 10 to the main circuit. I told you the reason why is it called the main circuit, because the actual output elements, that was your lamp H1 and your solenoid valve 1Y1, they are actually being controlled in current path number 9 and 10. Whereas in the previous 1 to 8 circuits, you are actually building up the logic. Okay, what should lead to my final control elements. Okay, so these are my control circuits. And all, of course, all 1 to 10 are known as my current paths. So these are all the current paths that is there. Fine. Then we will be coming to your terminal designation of a relay, because a relay will be using most often in the circuit, because all your signal processings and all those things are to be done with the relay itself. Okay. So relay, if you can recall, it will be designated by a capital letter K. And the number 1 and 2, all these things, they are to depend as to how many number of relays that you are using. If suppose you are using 10 relays, then you will name them as K1, K2, K3, K4, all the way up to K10. Fine. And A1 and A2 are your just connections to your relays, because these are your armature currents. Okay, that is here if you see A1 and A2. So of course, one will be your signal, the other would be your connected to your grounds. Okay. Finally, a relay can actually make or a break a contact. Okay, so you can have a multiple number of contacts in a relay. I told you I had explained the working of a relay in my previous lecture, where I told once you have this electromagnet that is energized, okay, this would actually pull this strip here, okay, made up of the ferromagnetic material, and in doing so, what it would do, it would actually whatever circuits are open here, it would make the circuit, and whatever circuit is closed, it will break the circuits. Okay, so these are the representations of the different circuit diagrams here. Okay, so if you see this relay K1 in an electrical circuit diagram, it would be represented in this way. Okay, so basically a relay is here, and you can have multiple contacts of the same relay. Fine. So relays would be there, and all the contacts here. For example, you are this letter 1 and 1 here shows your first contact. Similarly, 2 here shows your second contact. This is the third contact. This is the fourth contact of the same relays. Okay. And of course, 3 and 4 are normally used in an open circuit. Okay. And 1 and 2 is used for a normally closed circuit, even if you see in your all these diagrams here. Okay. So basically, all your open, even if you see your push button. Okay. So the numbers 3 and 4 actually shows that these are the standard representations of a normally open circuit. Had this been a closed circuit, then this would be denoted by 1 and 2. Okay. So a push, this is a push button S2, whereas once you make this symbolic representation, the letter 3 and 4, okay, associated with this actually represents that this is your make circuit. That is, initially the circuit is open, and whenever you press it, you will make the circuit. Okay. Similarly, if it is a normally closed contact, then that would be represented by a letter 1 and 2. Okay, if you see here in a previous, if any, yeah, see if here. Okay, so all your closed connections are represented by your letter 1 and 2, and your open connections are represented by your letter 3 and 4 here. Fine. So those are the things that will be used in the relays. Okay, so I have just shown you how a symbolic representation of a relay would be. Although here I am showing you that these connections are actually connected to the relay. Okay, so this is just an exact schematic representation of the same thing. But in actual operation, if you see here, okay, so this is one relay, okay, and this is an open contact of a same relay K1. Okay, you can have another place also. So if I see here, this is another make switch or an open contact of the same relay K1. That means whenever my K1 will get energized, this one will close. Okay, this will make a circuit. Similarly, this will make a circuit. Okay, you can also have a closed contact of the same relay K1. At that time, it would be represented by another value here. Okay, that will be closed here, and then you can use the same also. Fine, we will see it in a more detail in this. Okay, and see why we write a contact element table. If you see, when we are using the relay K1 here, so this shows it can either have a make contact, it can also have a break contact. Sorry, the left one is your break type of contacts, okay, and your right hand side is your make contacts or your normally open switches. Whenever it is engaged, it will make a circuit. So if you see here, K1, below your every relay you are going to have these type of contact element tables, okay, which shows that the relay K1 has a make circuit or a make switch at my current position, at my current path number 3 and my current path number 10, okay, so that it is easy to locate where are these different elements of this relay K1. So see here, if you go to current path number 3, this is a current path number 3 and this is a relay K1, you can see one open contact is used here, fine, of this relay K1. Similarly, if you see where is the another open contact of the same relay K1, it is in current path number 10. So if you go to see 10, if you see, okay, here is your another contact of the same relay K1, okay, and this is also a make type of contact, okay. So that means this is another contact denoted by a 1-4, and what does this letter 1 represent here? That this is the first contact, this is the second. Similarly, if you are going to have more number of contact, then that would be represented as 3-1, 3-4, 4-1, 4-4, 5-1, 5-4 to represent your all the make contacts of your relay K1. Similarly, if you have to represent a break contacts, then what you will be representing as? What you will be representing as? 1-2 and 1-3, because I told you the letter 2 and 3 are used, okay, to denote your normally closed contact, fine. So the contact element tables are shown here, okay. So if you are going to have 10 connections of the same relay here, so you will be writing all the current paths where those type of 10 connections are used here, okay. Make similarly, you may have 3-4 break type of contacts for the same relay, okay. So wherever those break contacts are used, okay, you will have to write those current paths here, so that it is easy to recognize where your all the different type of contacts element of your relay K1 is used here. Similarly, for K2, you will be making another contacts here, okay, fine, so that you can know where your all your different type of make and break switches of your relay K2 is used in the different current path of your electrical control diagram.
So when K1 is energized, the contactor, the K1, there are two K1,
yeah, So both
out of pitch, which by
both
one K1 is coming or other K1 is coming, how it will differentiate, sir? The contactor K1 is only one, but there are two contacts. So how that they understand that which K1, how this contact will energize? Will it energize in both?
Yeah, see, if suppose you have a relay here K1, and for that K1, if you have, say, suppose 10 make switches that is associated with K1, right? So in that case, the moment this relay is energized, all 10 will get energized at the same time.
Okay.
Fine. Because see, ultimately, if you see this diagram, once this element is getting pulled and, okay, so when this will break, it will lead to all your normally open contact to get closed, and all the normally closed contact, they will all open at the same time. Fine. Irrespective of how many contacts you have. Suppose we are, there are 30 contacts of a single relay K1, then all 30 will get actuated once, okay, at the same time. Fine.
Okay.
Okay. Now we will see what are the applications of a relay control system in an electro-pneumatic circuit. Okay. So as I have been repeating, okay, from the previous so many lectures, the entire signal processing needs of an electro-pneumatic control system can be implemented by relays, okay. However, if you see in my next module where I'll be covering your PLCs, there basically your PLC does all your signal control elements, and of course nowadays most of the systems in the industries are controlled by PLCs, where you are actually not going to see so many types of relays. But if suppose you want to work on a simple or a just like a electro-pneumatic systems, there you have to process all your signals through your relays. Fine. The principal advantage of a relay control systems are the clarity of the design and the ease of understanding. Like just in the previous circuit diagram, if you see here, you can know where are your different control elements of this and how are you going to use them either in a series manner or in a practical or in a parallel way, okay? So all your different elements will be combined together to process a certain logic, fine? So in that case, we'll be processing all our signals using different or numerous relays into our electro-pneumatic circuits, fine? Once we have introduced all the different type of symbolic representations of this, okay, and then our numberings and your different types of letters used to denote different components, and your numbering of your relays and your electrical circuit design considerations, we will now be going into making our some practical examples or some direct and indirect controls of the pneumatic cylinders. We will just try to execute our simple electro-pneumatic circuits now. So if you can just recall, we had done the same thing for our pneumatic systems also, okay, where we had done the direct control of a pneumatic cylinder, and then we also had done the indirect control of a single acting cylinder, then we followed it with direct and indirect control of our double acting cylinders, okay, in the pneumatic. So we will see how these circuits will be done in an electro-pneumatic way and where are the difference, okay, when we compare our electro-pneumatic systems to our pneumatic systems alone, fine. So for a direct control, what we have to see, suppose the piston rod of a single acting cylinder is to be extended when a push button S1 is pressed, okay, and retracted when the push button is released, okay. That is done here, okay. We can see a single acting cylinder, okay. Direct control, okay, see, I told you electro-pneumatic circuit will always have two components. So one will be your electrical circuit as designated here, and one will be your pneumatic circuit, okay. So a pneumatic component will consist of your single acting cylinders, 3x2 spring offset solenoid actuated valve, okay, because it is the solenoid actuated valve that actually forms your interface between your electrical circuit and your pneumatic or your power section, okay. And then you are going to have your compressor source also here, since this is a pneumatic. Had this been a hydraulic circuit, then you are going to have your pump and your electric motor arrangements to supply your pressurized oil into it, okay. Fine. So when I talk about my direct control, what I do, I use a push button denoted by my S1, okay, and this push button would directly energize my solenoid valve 1x1, okay. That means this solenoid valve that is there in this 3x2 solenoid operated valve, this will directly energize by a push button, okay. So this is known as your direct control of a single acting cylinder. However, when you go for indirect control of a single acting cylinder, just note here that your pneumatic circuit, there is no changes to your pneumatic circuit. Whatever change is there, it is there in the electrical portion. So here what we are doing, what do we call as indirect control? So for an indirect control, what we are doing, we are actually using a relay, okay, and through that relay we are energizing our solenoid valve 1x1, okay. So using a push button, what we are doing, we are energizing this relay, and we are using a make contact of a relay, the same relay, this one K1, to energize our solenoid valve, okay. So this is known as your indirect control, control of a single acting cylinder. What is the advantage, anyone? If you can just draw your analogy to your indirect control of a single acting cylinder in case of a pneumatic system, okay, where we used a pneumatic signal to actuate another 3x2 valve to control your, to extend your single acting cylinder, instead of directly extending it using a 3x2 valve, push button valve. So anyone?
Sir, if you require large amount of force, let's wait.
Yeah, of course. Because see, if you see the construction of your relay, okay, you have your armature coil, okay, which can work on a very small amount of say voltage, okay. But if suppose the spools of the signals that are to be shifted inside, okay, if that has to work at a higher current ampere, at a higher voltage, okay, then what would happen? If you see the construction of your relay here, so these contacts can have different amount of currents running in, fine, whereas your relay is actuated by your low voltage contact itself, because it just requires your energizing of your armatures, which will actually just try to make or break a circuit, which is very this entire shifting, okay, of the plate is very, very light, so that can happen. However, your current, okay, so now initially say suppose this current is very small, or we are working on suppose 24 volt system. However, if you want to require a say 220 volt system to energize your bigger solenoid valves or your lamps, different lamps and motors, okay, then what we do, those you can actually connect it with different types of voltage systems here, okay. Thus, if you see that this is your direct control, where in this case you are directly using the same amount of voltage and your electrical current to energize this valve. Here you are just using a relay, and that relay connection, okay, in a make switch form, it is used to energize this solenoid valve. Okay. Now again,
so the K1 is in open circuit, sir. Why it is not connected in series, sir? Then it will become direct. If K1, if after S1 we put the K1 contact, sir, not contactor. If you are putting S1 and K1 in series, then also
this one here, good. Here. If,
yes, sir. K1 there, K1. The contact, sir, not the contact.
Yes, this K1 in where do you want to put?
After S1, sir.
After S1, here.
Yes, sir. In series, the moment the push button takes is done, the circuit is closed and K1 get energized.
No, how will initially, but that will be your open contact, no? So that time your circuit will not get closed, no? To energize your K1 relay, because it will be an open contact. So if I place it here, this circuit will not be complete. Even if I close the circuit, it will be an open circuit.
Okay.
Right?
Okay.
Yeah. So this is an indirect control of a single acting cylinder. Okay. Now from this, can you tell, will there be any difference in the electrical control of a if I make a suppose a direct control of a double acting cylinder, you will be seeing there is no change in the electrical circuit, right? Okay, what will be the change? It will be only in the pneumatic portion. Fine. So instead of a single acting cylinder, now what you have a double acting cylinder, and to control this double acting cylinder, you require a 5x2 a spring offset single solenoid operated valve. Okay. However, a direct control, what you are doing, you are actually just trying to energize this valve. Okay. So the electrical circuit for both, if you just see this direct control of a single acting cylinder, this is my electrical circuit, and direct control of my double acting cylinder, this is my electrical circuit, both remains the same. Where does the circuit changes? Circuit changes in the pneumatic section. Okay, so just instead of a single acting cylinder and a 3x2 valve, okay, what do we have here? We have a double acting cylinder and a 5x2 valve. Fine, and your electrical circuit would remain same. Now to the indirect control of a double acting cylinder, again it is the same way here. You will be first actuating a relay, and then you will be using a make qualified relay to actuate this solenoid valve, which will lead to your extension of this cylinder. Okay, so these are your indirect and direct control of a double acting and your single acting cylinders. Fine. Now with this, we'll be moving on to our logic operations. Okay. Now just try to recall your logic operations that we did in the your purely pneumatic circuit, where we had two 3x2 push button valve. Okay. And then when either of the two was pressed, our requirement was that the cylinder, either it is a single acting cylinder or a double acting cylinder, extends by either pressing my push button valve S1 or S2. Okay. And for that, what did we require? We required another component. Okay. And that was your shuttle valve. Fine. Okay. And if you just try to see this here. Okay, so you do not need any extra component for this, because why? You are working with an electrical signals, right? So if you see here, if I just have these two push buttons here, because there I will be having a push button valve. Since we are doing an electro-pneumatic circuit, we do not have a push button valve here. We will be just be having our push button switches, okay, or your push buttons itself. So you can have two push buttons here. If you place them in just parallel, then this executes your OR logic. Another circuit diagram is shown here. This is also an OR logic. What is the difference between this and this? Anyone?
Directly controlled and indirectly controlled.
Yeah, good. So this is a direct control, okay, with implementation of an OR logic. This is a implementation of OR logic with indirect control. Why? You are using a relay and then you are using a mixed switch of relay to control to actuate your solenoid valve. Okay. Similarly, just to make give you a variety of configuration, I have done this both for two different type of cylinders. Okay. So this is my OR circuit, direct actuation with a single acting cylinders. Okay. This is my OR circuit with indirect control and my double acting cylinder here. Okay. So now you must be able to draw. Now you must be able to recall in a better way. Okay. Like what are the basic differences that is there when we are talking about our pneumatic control systems and when we are talking about our electro-pneumatic control systems. Okay. What were the different type of elements? Because there all your control elements were press were processed through your pneumatic signals. Everywhere you had your whenever you press two push button valves, you had your two pilot line coming. Okay, then that two pilot line was processed through a shuttle valve. Again, the output of the shuttle valve was again a pilot pressure. Okay, and that pilot pressure, where did you put? You put it here. Okay, to extend that pneumatic cylinder in case of a purely pneumatic circuit. Whereas in case of an electro pneumatic circuit, if you see, these are your input elements, your S1 and S2. Okay, your relays. Okay, are your processing elements. Okay, and then that output is nothing but your 1x1 solenoid valve here. Okay, so whenever your electrical signal, the final is your electrical signal here. So when that is coming here, this spool would shift and your cylinder would extend. Fine. So this is a parallel circuit. Similarly, you have your series circuit. Okay, fine, where you just have to connect those push buttons. Okay, in your series to actuate your AND logic in case of an electro-pneumatic circuit. Even if you see your pneumatic circuit diagram for both your OR circuit as well as your AND circuit, they both remain the same. Okay, there is no changes to it. Where are the changes? The changes are in the electrical circuit, because I told you all your logic processing and all, they are all done in the electrical portion of your circuit diagram. Your pneumatic portion does not have any control elements, okay, in case of a electro-pneumatic circuit. Okay, so that is why if you see in case of both your single acting cylinder and your double acting cylinders executing an OR logic or an AND logic, both the pneumatic section is the same. Okay, and the only changes are there in your electrical sections. Fine. I think we'll stop here. Okay, we'll continue the rest portion of the circuit, okay, of today's lecture in tomorrow's class or in the next week. So we'll stop here.